Father, in Jesus' name, I feel like today, you know, today is a day of new beginnings. It's a new time. It's a new season. It's a new beginning. This is like, you know, us starting brand new all over again from the very beginning. That's what's happening today. It's prophetic in the way that it's a new start and a new beginning in your life and what God is calling us to. So Father, in Jesus' name, Lord, I thank you, Father, for what you're doing. Lord, I thank you, Father, that you've given us eyes to see and ears to hear. I thank you, Father, that you call us your church, you know, where you dwell. Father, we invite your spirit. Father, we invite you to be with us. Lord, I ask that you would lead this church, Father, us, the ones that you have called out, Lord, that you would lead us the way that you would have us to go. Lord, that this church would be built according to your design. And Lord, we just give it to you. I don't want it. I don't want it, Lord. I just want to be a part of what you're doing. That's it, Father. So today, as a dedication to you, Lord, it's not the building, Father. It's just this body of believers, Father, we dedicate to you. Help us to be what you've called us to be, servants and your house. And Lord, we ask that you would bring those that are supposed to be here, Father, so that we can serve you by serving others. And you can just lead us where it is that we're supposed to go and what we're supposed to do in these end times, Father. We thank you for it, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, and amen. Yes.
Can I interrupt just for one
minute? You ain't interrupting. You letting the spirit flow. Come on.
I just want to say this much. I was in here while y'all were playing worship music. I was praying for two people.
It needs to be on there.
I was praying for two people. One for our friend. His back is really hurting him. He can't even hardly move. And I was praying for my sister. She's having a really rough time ever since my daddy died. I mean, it's been a year and a half, but she just can't. There's no hope right now for her. So I was praying, and I was trying to pray for more people, but it just kept telling me to pray for those two, which is our friend Daryl and my sister Regina. Well, she never calls me during church. Well, she just called me. So I went outside to answer the phone, and she's like, "You're never going to believe this." She goes, "But I was sound asleep, and something hit me in the back of my head and woke me up." And I said, "Well, I'm just going to let you know, sis." I said, "I was praying for you." I said, "I was asking God to put his hands on you to heal you." So wow. I was just started crying.
Wow.
So I'm just letting you know that that's unbelievable. Yeah. How God can answer a prayer so quickly. Because she is really hurting. Inside, really hurting.
And you know, right, that is just a confirmation that the Lord's with us.
Yes.
Because signs and wonders follow, right?
Yes.
And as the first one that came, that's awesome.
Yes.
You know, we have, and I'm glad she come out because, you know, we got some people out of sick, you know, that's down. You know, Brother Joe is in the hospital right now, you know, Madge and Joe, and he's okay. He had to get some tests done and stuff like that. So I don't know if he'll be home today or tomorrow or whenever, but he's doing good, right? They had to run some tests on his heart and, you know, check a few things. Yeah. They put a stent in, but, you know, the good thing is Madge told me he was doing okay. He was doing fine. And 3 o'clock in the morning, she sends me a text, and I'm up. I see my phone go off, you know, and I'm like, so I look at it, and she says, you know what, I'm going to read what she said on it, so you'll know. She sends me this text, and she says, it was pretty amazing. It kind of, so she sends me this text at 2:55 a.m. in the morning. Now, you got to know Madge and Joe. Madge, they in a hospital, and this is what she tells me. Sorry, we will not be in service in person, but we will be there in spirit. We are praying God will give you wisdom to give a spirit-filled message for our church. We will be able to see and hear it on YouTube. This attack on Joe was meant for evil, but it turned out for good because we have more power than the devil. Because we have Jesus living in us. When Joe was on the missions trip to St. Croix, he met this black evangelist that taught him this song. When life's problems come your way, hold your hands up and shout hallelujah anyhow.
Aww.
Right? Tonight, we are singing that song. We love you. Happy birthday. We pray God will bless you.
Hallelujah.
So Joe, that's, we sing hallelujah anytime, you know, when life things, you know, seems to be throwing at us. Let me tell you, it's been a tough time, right? Man, everybody going through some stuff right now. But God says, sing hallelujah anyhow, which is really good. All right, let's get started. Wow. Y'all ready? Fasten your seatbelts. Y'all buckled in. You know me. I got a phone call this last week after service. I come outside, catch this phone call. It's a friend of mine that comes, I know for a while now, Jeff and Tammy. They had a church cross or gates or something up there in Gulfport. They usually come when we have Passover and stuff like that. Got to meet him. They invited me to go minister at their church up in Gulfport and crossroads or cross gates or something like that. But anyway, last week at the service, I get this phone call from him. So after service is over, I come out here. He said, hey, man. He said, how you doing, brother? I said, I'm doing good, Jeff, man. He said, look, I got a guy that wants to, you know, Brother Paul? He said, that came over by your dad's house when he was dying. And I'm not dying. When your dad had cancer, he came over to pray and stuff like that. And I said, yeah. He said, it was me and Paul and Brother Andrew and some other men. And he said, well, Paul wants to talk to you. He said, and I wanted to make sure this was still your phone number. Is it okay if I give him your phone number? I'm like, yeah. So I get this phone call from Paul. This is about 7 o'clock or so at night. I'm by the house, and I'm carving some bears, okay? And, you know, I stop, and I said, hey, man, what's going on? He said, brother, he said, man, I got to get together with you. You have to, I want to get you together with somebody. And I said, what's going on? He said, well, first, he said that, we're building a new church right now. And Ching, you know, goes off right off the bat, you know. Just starting the church, he said, and you know, it's kind of crazy because God told me that I need to build it according to the Bible, the biblical church, right? And he said, and right now, you know, 2 weeks ago, he said, I ministered on the fivefold ministry and how the importance of, you know, we all got to do our part, the gifts of the Spirit, and let God use us. And I'm like, brother, you have no idea. I said, it's the same message I ministered 2 weeks ago, too. And I said, we just got the church and everything that's going on. And he said, well, brother, we got to get together. You got to meet this man. Man, you guys speak the same language. He built the tabernacle just like you. And he said he's 86 years old. And man, I got to get you together. Man, we got to get together. He said, you know, are you working or anything? I said, no. He said, can we get together this week? He said, I'll call up Brother Seymour and I'll talk to him and see if we can get together, because you need to get together with him. So he calls me back and he said, look, I can do it Thursday. Brother Seymour can see you Thursday, you know, and we can get together with him. This man's, he's been in ministry for 65 years. He's a pastor of an Assembly of God church. He built the tabernacle 25 years ago, okay? And So I go by Paul's house. I go out to Gulfport, go by Paul's, and we load up in a truck, and you know, I ain't seen him in a while, and Paul had said a few things to me. He you know, just coming out of a serious battle of cancer. He liked to die 3 times, and they removed all kind of stuff in him, but he fought through, and now he's pastor, and God has called him the pastor of this church, and he's just putting his church together. You know, no coincidence that all of this is happening at this time right now. Same message God speaks to him by the Spirit. He speaks to us to do what's happening. So we get in the truck and we talking a little bit, you know, we go down to Pastor Seymour's house. We get over there and we go up to the front door, knock on the door. He comes and, you know, this man walks out and he said, let's go over there to my shop area. You know, so we go over there by his shop. We walk in the door, and it's probably about, I'd say his shop is probably about as long as this is right here, about this wide. He's got his desk and all that set up in there. And we walked in the door, his desk is set up, and then I see the tabernacle pieces he's kind of got in line. He ain't got them, they just sitting there, you know. Got some sofas and stuff like that. On a wall, he's got this chart that's about, I don't know, 25, 30 foot long, 8 foot tall, from creation all the way to the end, and he teaches on end times and you know, and all of this kind of stuff. So, you know, we walk in there and we sit down, and Paul told me, he said, look, when you come, he said, make sure you bring you the pictures of, you know, the pieces that you built, because you guys speak the same language. I want them to see it. So we go in there and, you know, walk in, and Brother Seymour sits down and Paul sits down and I sit down. Now I'm on an angle like this with Brother Seymour on this angle, and right next to Brother Seymour is Paul. So right when I sit down, the Lord says, Brother Seymour begins, right when he begins to speak, the Lord just began to talk. Hey man, how you doing? Small talk and this and that. As we walk in and we sit down, the Lord said, get a pen and paper. So I grabbed my pen and I'm like, man, Lord, I don't have any paper. You know, so I said, Brother Seymour, before you know, can I get a piece of paper from you? So he gets up and he gives me this this little book. He gives me some scratch sheet paper first, but he says, no. He said, here, I'm going to give you this. And he gives me this little scratch pad. For the next hour and a half, I listened to this man talk, but not to me. I watched him talk to Paul. Now, Paul is in a process of building a church. Okay? He's a new church, just starting. Brother Seymour is the pastor of an Assembly of God church. Brother Seymour is letting Paul and these men start a church in there. They have a gym. And on Saturdays at 5:30 in the evening, they have in their church there. They just started, okay? So I grabbed the paper and, you know, first thing out of his mouth, he says, Paul looks at the altar of incense. I'm sorry, the table of showbread, his table of showbread, and says, he says, brother, what's that? He said, man, what did you make that stuff out of? You know, and Paul looks at him, I mean, Brother Seymour, Norwood Seymour, looks at him and says, man, I made that out of poplar wood. And then he goes on and starts talking about poplar and how he built it. Now, I want to just connect a dot for you really quick. When God called this church out 5 years ago, first thing I did was I built the RV park right next door to my house. The whole RV park is built out of poplar, 6,000 square foot building. It was the first place I was asked to pastor. In Poplarville. I mean, at the RV park next door to the house, that I helped build the whole entire park out of poplar. The church, God, when he called me to pastor, or the church opened, he opened the church to show you how precise God is, because what happened then is repeating itself now today. It's a new beginning and a new start. When God called us to Poplarville, I told the Lord, we went all over the place, and we went to Poplarville, and I said, Lord, there ain't nothing in Poplarville. He said, yes, there is. You are. I'm like,
yes, sir.
That's where God called. So the building that opens up to me to begin to pastor in is in Poplarville, and it's the Barry Harper RV dealership. Campers. I built the RV park out of Poplar. God brings us to Poplarville in an RV dealership building, you know, where I begin to pastor, where 15 years or, yeah, well, actually about 10 years earlier, I was asked to pastor next door, but it didn't, because it was a plan that God had in the future. So check this out. This is what he says. And I'm going to read these notes. First thing he says is, poplar wood. He said, let me get my other one. Let me just show you really quick. These are the notes that I took from this man when I was sitting down there. That's all I did was write. I said very few words. All I did was listen to him and wrote. Wow. Because God was speaking, okay? So, first thing he says is about the poplar wood, poplar, which grabbed my attention. And he says, man, you guys, we're going somewhere that is going to be absolutely mind-blowing. He says, talk about the meeting with our Brother Paul and Pastor Norwood Seymour. We go into the office, and the first thing he begins to talk about is how he built the pieces of the tabernacle out of poplar. He said that poplar is a very special wood, that it never ceases to die, meaning, it never ceases to go dormant, is the word he used, with expanding and contraction and stuff like that. Then he talked about, instantly, he says, right when he's talking about these pieces, and Paul is looking at it, then, right after he says that, he talked about when he was young, how he built their first church. Now, God is telling me to pay attention to every word that he's saying, because God is speaking something right now. Everything. Listen to what he says. Then he started talking about when he was young, a young man, how he built their first church. Back to the beginning. He took me all the way back. Now I'm just sitting there listening. Out of old log siding, and at that time there was no electricity where they were living. First church he builds is out of log siding. That's what I'm building my house with. Log siding is on side of wrap my beams and all the stuff. He said they packed the logs with mud and would watch the mice run on the logs while they were sitting in church. There was no electricity. So he's talking about building a church. First church. Just out of the blue, he just starts talking about it. Then he begins to tell us where he purchased the poplar for the tabernacle pieces that he built. Right? He said, a friend of mine up north built a big church. It's crazy. Built a big church all out of poplar. And told Brother Norwood Seymour, if he needed any, he would give it to him for a very good price. He bought a whole tractor trailer load for $90.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
So you went up there, got a tractor trailer load of poplar for $90. Came back with the poplar. This man, just all he's talking about now is poplar wood. And I'm like, I'm sitting there, I'm like, wow. Just listening to him, because where God called the church to, I'm familiar. Then he starts talking about the sawmill and the cutting of the boards, and I'm like, everything he's saying in the natural about the sawmill, the poplar, the cutting, what it looks like, the green, the brown, its identity, I have firsthand experience with it. Because of, I worked with it for a year and a half on a sawmill, and then used it to build with my neighbor, where God first called me to pastor, right? Crazy, but God. He says, next, he begins to tell Paul, when God tells you something like this, When God tells you to build something like this, and he's pointing at the showbread table and the Ark of the Covenant, the Ark of Testimony, he says this. He said that God gives you a special anointing to do it. Now, this man went from talking about poplar wood and the detail of what it was, and I had firsthand knowledge and experience, and I understood what he was trying to explain to Paul. I knew what it was. Then he says, he looks and he said, hey brother, David. Then he says, you see those cherubims on the mercy seat? He said, I carved them out of one piece. He's a carver.
Wow.
Brother David just came by the house. Day before yesterday. You know what our conversation was about? What was our conversation about, David?
Cherubs.
About cherubs. Right. God, he is so in our face. Watch. He says, you see those cherubs, those cherubims on the mercy seat? I call them wings and everything. But what you see there, it's only a box. He's got on his, there's a cherubim has four wings, not two wings like this. This is wrong, right? He's supposed to have four wings. His cherubim that was sitting on top of the mercy seat with a set of wings like this and then a set of wings coming around. Beautiful, it was beautiful. His furniture that he built was beautiful. So he says, He said, you see those wings and all of that? He said, I carved them. But what you see, he said, Paul, he said, listen, that's only a box. That only represents something. He said, if God would come back today, or if right now today they found the Ark of the Covenant, it doesn't mean anything. It's just a box, Paul. And he's looking at Paul the whole time, and I'm writing. He said, God told Moses to build it for beauty and for glory to reveal who Jesus was and is. Now, I'm sitting there listening to this 86-year-old man telling Paul about these pieces. I understand not only the physical aspect of what he's talking about and what they mean, But I understand the call to build it. I understand the anointing that God put on him to build it. You can't explain it. He's trying to tell him. But I have firsthand experience or understanding of something that is so out there to others. Like to Paul, he was oblivious to what was going on. Then he said, Paul, listen, Paul is building a church. He's building a church right now. Paul, and then Norwood Seymour, Brother Norwood Seymour, is looking at Paul dead in his eyes, and he says to him, he said, God told Moses, build it according to the pattern that I showed you. So, and I want to, it was hammered, and he says, and he's looking at the lampstand. He's talking about the lampstand. He says, you know, Paul, like the lampstand. He said, God told him to build it according to the pattern that God showed him. He said, God told Moses to build it to the very detail. Don't leave anything out. Nothing. It was made out of hammered gold, beaten out of one piece. This is what he begins to talk about. He says, in fact, I'm working on that piece right now. God told me, you know, to build it a year ago. This man has been in ministry for 65 years.
Wow.
He built the tabernacle of Moses, or the tabernacle of testimony is a better way to put it, because it's a testimony of who Jesus is. He tells him that the only thing he hasn't built was the lampstand, the menorah. It's the only thing he hasn't built. But a year ago, God told him to build it. So now, in his shop, he's beginning to build this menorah, right? Then he said, you know what's amazing about the pieces, Paul? He says the imperfections in it. God wanted it built for beauty and for glory, but gold is hammered. It wasn't polished perfect. And he says, I wrote, talk about the imperfections. And it's over, and I wrote here as a note for me, that it's okay for people to see your imperfections. I was told as a pastor, don't let people know when you're going through a hard time. Don't let people know when you're battling. Don't let them know, because then they won't look at you the same. Well then, if I don't let you know that I'm a man like you, then I'm up on a pedestal.
Yeah.
Uh-uh. You notice I don't minister from up here?
Right.
Never have. If you know that I battle and go through things, you can relate to that.
That's right.
He said, I hate to do this, but I need to do it so I'll stay focused, because you know me, I'll take off and start running.
Yeah.
And I'm going to get to that point in a minute, in a little bit. And then he says, no, talk about every imperfection. It's okay for people to see them so they can relate and not lift you up instead of Jesus.
That's right.
Right? So I asked him right here for the first time after being in there for a while. I said, I asked Brother Seymour, when did you build this and why did you build it? Because now I'm like, I want to know. I see people build things because it's cool or because it's nice. You know, the Noah's Ark. Why would you build Noah's Ark? Oh man, I thought it was good. People, they buy them. They have people build it for them. I listened to this man. This is what he said. I asked him, Brother Seymour, when did you build all of this and why did you build it? And he said, I built the pieces 25 years ago, and I started with the Ark of the Covenant.
Wow.
The very thing I started with.
Yeah. Wow.
The very piece. I built it because I wanted to be able to show the people a visual. So I studied it and I built it according to God's word. Same thing God told me. I have now been in ministry and pastoring for 65 years. And the only piece I haven't finished yet is the lampstand. Come on, and I'll show it to you. Prior to him leaving, he began to tell Paul, looking at him, he said, Paul, when God called me to build these pieces, I can't even tell you what happened, what come over me. He said, there was times I can go back there and I can build, and there was times I couldn't. I understood that.
Yeah.
It took 2 years for us to build the pieces. Times we can work on it. The Spirit would come. You ever feel like, man, I got to go get in my word. I got to go get in my word. Right?
Yeah.
That's the Spirit drawing you. That's what happened with me. I was drawn to it. And what was happening, it took me 2 years to build the furniture with my dad. But what was happening in the process of building it, it was being built inside of me. So I couldn't go and start a piece until that piece was already in me. Because you're a house. He begins to explain this to him. I understand, I don't even know how to put it into words, the very essence, the smell, the Spirit of God hovering so you can do what it is that God has called you to do. He's trying to get this out in words. It's about, Paul is building a house right now. He's trying through the Spirit. He doesn't even know it. The Spirit is trying to impart into Paul, build it according to the pattern that I'm showing you. What does the church look like? That's right. But boy, it goes way deeper than that. Paul says, come on, I'll show you the peace. I'll show you the peace. We walk out the door. We start walking down to his shop. Parked next to his shop is a big old bus. Destroyed. He said, you know, don't ask me about that bus. That bus is a long story. I said, and we're walking up to it. So this bus is destroyed. We walk around the bus. Right behind the bus is this little shop. Little shop. He opened the doors and walked in the shop, and when I walked in, man, God took me back 16 years to my beginning. The smell, this menorah in the pieces. You know, he said, I began to cry because it brought me back to when I was with my dad building it. He said, you know, there's something special about the menorah. We really don't know what it really, really looked like. He said, and you know, I saw your picture and how you did it. He said, and the one that I'm building is after, you know, the one that the rendition of the menorah they have right now in Israel that they're going to use in the next temple. And he said, so it's a little bit different, but he said, you know, they really don't know exactly what it looked like. And I said, you know, brother, I said, the only picture we really have of the menorah is on the Arch of Titus when it was carried to Rome. You see, Rome has all the pieces except the Ark. So anyway, so I walked up in that shop and I'm looking at this menorah and I asked him, I said, hey brother, I said, you know, can I take a picture of it? So Carl, can you put the picture of that menorah up he's building? He said,
wow.
He said, that's his little shop. It's all made of poplar. That's 350 pieces. He said, I have 350 pieces in it right now. He said, and it's only finished on one side. I got to finish the other side.
Wow.
He said, a year ago, God called me to build a menorah. He said, and is I started working on it. And he said, then my wife got sick. And I had to stop a year ago, 1 year. 1 year, that cycle. He said, I had to stop, I couldn't finish it. He said, but my wife's doing better now, and you know, I'm still pastoring the church, but I wasn't pastoring as often as I was because I was dealing and helping my wife, you know. He said, but I'm feeling better now. And he said, I'm gonna finish the menorah. So Paul is looking at it and he's like, wow, but I'm rubbing my hands on the wood. You know, Vicky, you bring me something with carpentry. Not only you, a chainsaw. Did I tell you Brother Seymour's a carver? A couple of weeks ago, not even a week and a half ago, whatever it was, all of a sudden, I start carving. Just even ask the Lord, why am I carving? In fact, Charlene says, you know what you're doing? I said, no. She said, that's art by subtraction. She said, what you're doing is taken away so that you can reveal. My God. Paul looks at me and says, brother, it's kind of crazy. You guys not only talk the same language, and I didn't say anything. Brother Norwood Seymour was looking at him, talking to him the whole time. I just said one thing that grabbed Brother Seymour's attention, and I'll tell you in a minute. He said, not only are you guys Not only do you guys talk the same language, y'all dress the same. I said, what? You see, to him, when I got up that morning, I went in my closet. What I'm about to tell you, and I wouldn't lie to you, I got up, I looked in the closet, said, Lord, what am I going to wear? Slipped my jeans and my boots on. What shirt, you know, I'm going to put my black shirt on. What, I mean, you know. He said, put on the red flannel. I said, okay. So I put my red flannel shirt on. Put it on, went outside, went in the mirror, brushed my teeth, and I was looking at it like that. I'm like, man, it's kind of wrinkled, you know. I throw it in the dryer. No, I said, my daughter bought me a brand new red flannel shirt. I went inside and I grabbed that red flannel shirt and I put it on. He says to me while I'm there, Paul, brother, you're not only dressed the same, y'all only talk the same language, but y'all dressed exactly the same way. Paul,
Oh, wow.
Now, wait. It gets better than that. The very shirt that he's wearing is the very shirt I put on first. Listen to me. I promise to God before you. I didn't notice it till this morning. God had me look at the shirt. The very shirt that I put on this morning, he got that shirt from Walmart. I had that very shirt on that was wrinkled. And I said, I can't wear that shirt, Lord. I'm kind of wrinkled. And I'm like, you know what? But he had me, I put the other red shirt on, but the same shirt, right? You think that's those little things are by coincidence? No, indeed not. Right. Paul was identifying him as him and I speaking the same language. And all this man talks about is building. So now, we walk out the shop after we took a picture. And right outside the shop's the old boss. He said, well, I guess I'll tell you about that old boss. I said, what old boss? And he looked at me and he laughed. He said, you know, I had that bus parked up at the church. Here's the church again. He said, and I was making it into a home. Here's a house he's building. A master craftsman. He said, but you know what? He said, I got the motor in, it's like new. All the inners and all this stuff. And he said, and I went up there one day and the whole bus was destroyed. It was vandalized. Oh. Busted all the windows out of this big old massive, I'm talking about a coach bus. It was destroyed. And I started writing. Because you see, it means something. A bus is a church. He was building a home on the move. A bus moves. The church moves. He was building a home. It was parked at a church. Right? You start connecting the dots. From the time that I got there to the time I left, all he talked about was building a house. Build it according to the pattern I showed you. Which brings us all the way back to the very beginning. What did the church actually look like? Right? So, he said, as I'm writing this, it's, you know, early in the morning, 5 o'clock now, probably or so. He says, I built it because I wanted to be able to show the people a visual. So, I studied it, and I built it according to God's word. He built a furniture pieces, a tabernacle, a dwelling place for God to dwell. Those pieces go inside of a tent, and you're that tent. Each piece has to be built inside of you. Man, listen to this. I have now been in ministry and pastoring for 65 years. 6 and 5 is 11. Transition. He said, when I went in Jerusalem, I went underground to where the ark is. 29 of us went. 9 and 2 is 11. Transition, people. You see? Remember I told you about the 11s, the transition, and what it means, and all of this stuff. And listen, he's 86 years old, this man. Everything is of importance. When God called us to this church, it was a transition time. 11s kept coming, coming, coming. So, when I went to Brother Bob and bought the chairs that you're sitting on, there's 83 you're sitting on in here. There's 83. 8 and 3 is 11. Bob lives at 56 Bonner Lake Road. 5 and 6 is 11. You know what's crazy? I said, Lord, what's up with the number 86? Because pastor, he was 86 years old. Do you know, last Saturday, Bob and I were standing up talking right there. He said, brother, you got, you know, he said, all the chairs sit up in here? Fit? I said, yeah, they fit, you know, good. He said, but I have 3 more that I would hate to get rid of, but I'll give them to you. 86 for the church. Man, some people see and some people don't. Paul, God was trying to reveal something to Paul on how to build his house. And he was telling him, Paul, build it according to the plan I'm showing you. Listen to this. He says, come on, I'll show it to you. He said a year ago he started building it. He always wanted to, but never could find the time. Shortly after beginning, his wife became deathly sick, and he could not finish it. But now she is a little better. And he said that now he's going to finish it and be able to pastor every week at his assembly of God. Church. Assembly, right? In Gulfport. Through the year, he missed a lot, but never quit. And he said, I am ready to go back full time. This church has been out of commission for a year. And we're back in Poplarville, set up and ready. Watch, he says, I remember as I walked into his little shop, feelings of my past overwhelmed me, and of when my dad and I was building the very same pieces. Tears welled up as Brother Seymour began to describe the detail that he had put into the lampstand. He said, I have 350 pieces on it, and right now, I still have to finish the other side. I took a picture to show you guys. As we're walking to his little shed, to see his lampstand, there was an old bus next to the shop, and he said, as we were walking past, as we was walking past it, whatever you do, don't ask me about that old bus. After seeing the menorah and taking a few pictures, Paul said, let me get a picture of you two brothers together. He said, not only do you speak the same language, but you are dressed exactly the same. Blue jeans and a red flannel shirt. As a note, before I left home, I asked the Lord, "What shirt, Lord, should I wear?" He said, "The red flannel." Wow. As we walked out of the shop, Brother Seymour said, "All right, I'll tell you about this old bus." And I said to him, "What old bus?" And he laughed. He said, "I was going to make a motor home of it. I did all kind of work on the motor, the alternator, the air systems. It was all perfect. The inner makings of this bus, the inner parts are good." Pick up where I was at. He said, talking about the motor home. He said, "I did all kind of work on the motor, the alternator, and the systems. It was perfect. And then where I left it, parked by the church, it was vandalized and destroyed. See all the windows broken out, beat up, front windshield smashed. So I just brought it home, and here it sits." Right? He says, as we are walking to the truck, Brother Seymour says, "Brother Paul, you would not believe what it took for us to build this house." This guy never stopped talking about building, right? He said, Paul then says to me, "You see that house next door?" This Paul tells me now. He said, "That's his son's house. He died. I helped build it." From the moment Brother Seymour began to speak, 95% of the time, he was looking at Paul as trying to get him to understand. The Lord said, "Sit and listen and take notes to what he was saying." He says, "When I was sitting there taking all of these notes, the Lord spoke to me and said, his name, Brother, is a carver, Norwood Seymour. You gnaw on the wood and you'll see more." That's what I've been doing. That's what you guys gave me today. A chainsaw. So I could carve. The name, so that, because what Brother Norwood did, Brother Norwood Seymour. John called it perfect yesterday here. Where's he at, John? When I said, "Yeah, Brother Seymour," he just kind of went, "Huh, Seymour. Wow," he said, "Seymour." I wrote, "Brother Norwood Seymour." And on side of his name, I wrote, "A master craftsman in his trade." When I said those words, when I was sitting down at the table, the Lord spoke to me. He had been speaking to me. This is what he said to me. "It takes a master craftsman to reveal another master craftsman. He'll never finish the menorah." The Lord said, little does he know, he's been working on the menorah, my church, for 65 years. And the reason that I called him to build the menorah, start building it a year ago, is because it's the end of his ministry. And he thinks he's about to go back to working on this menorah. What was happening, Brother Norwood, a master craftsman in his trade, was trying to, by the Spirit, impart into Paul the pattern of how you build God's church. He said, it takes a master craftsman. Let me tell you something. When I started the church 5 years ago, I told the Lord, I don't know how to build a church. But I knew what His Word said. I said, Lord, so send me master craftsmen in their trade to help me build Your house. For the first time in 16 years, the Lord called me a master craftsman. And He said, you're writing His eulogy because you're the only one that could reveal who He is. You're the only one that can describe. And I realized at about 5 o'clock in the morning yesterday that I was writing about Him passing and Him leaving and Him trying to impart into something that was so special into someone who just totally missed it. Because he don't understand the pattern. The first pattern that was ever given on how to build God's house. The pieces have to be built inside of you. Because in the house of God, as priest, all you do is assist. When they would come to the altar, and you would bring your sacrifice. If you have to leave, you can go. You would bring it to a priest who understood and knew the tabernacle or the temple, who was intimate with its pieces, understood its operation and how it works, so that when you came to the altar to bring your sacrifice, he was only there to assist you, and it was what you were supposed to be doing. You bring that lamb to the altar. He doesn't kill it. You do.
Right.
He doesn't skin it and rip the flesh off. You do. How does that apply to the church? You come up there looking for direction. Like in prison last night when we went and ministered. God's telling me. I'm trying to explain. I'm telling these guys. The power of God was so strong in that place. These men in there were just from worship. 14 men. One left. 14 men grabbed, just being held by everything that's being said, captivated. The whole cell singing. It was like the first time we ever heard something like that loud, right? I mean, the whole cafe was full of voices. It was amazing. And I began to explain to them and tell them the process of coming to God. You need to know that. Because your job is to assist people in leading them to God. Because they don't know. But if they want to come to the Lord, you need to be able to explain to them what an altar is, what it means. You come, someone comes, not to this altar, that brass brazing altar. What does it mean? Explain it to me. Because before you can become a house of God in service, these pieces have to be erected inside of you. And that's what God's doing now, putting His house in order. It's all about the menorah. The menorah is the church. The menorah is the church. That man has been working on the church for 65 years. We just changed our emblem to the menorah. We was a lighthouse. God called us, you know, put it as a menorah. I even got rebutted on it. No, I'm not standing down. Do you know that the menorah is actually a coat of arms? When I set these pieces up 2 weeks ago, when I came in here, I was taking the stuff out of the trailer, setting it back up for the first time. The ark wasn't going to be there. The ark was going to be to the side, but God said, no, it's got to go there. The pieces has got to be set up inside of you. Enemy trying to get in all kind of ways, right? When I came in, we brought everything in, I'm in a trailer. This book is on the shelf. The Mystery of the Menorah. When I come in here and we set everything up, I felt like it needed to be there. And that's where I put it. And that's where it stayed. The other thing that was done was I felt like I had to put, this is my dad. This is the first time the tabernacle was ever displayed. Ever. December 26th, 2004. What? Man. My God. You hear what I just said? We just set it up. The first time this was ever set up in its life, in the history of it. When I set this temple up, my dad played Moses. Resurrection life. I got the minister because Alan went away on vacation or thing. So I was allowed. So we set the tabernacle up for the first time December 26th. We set it up again. When do we have our first service? December 24th. Here it is. Absolutely. And how amazing is God? Here it is. He has me drop the book. Yeah.
We did the production on the 26th, but that stuff was there in resurrection on the 24th.
On the 24th? Oh, yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
We set it up before. That's right.
Before Christmas.
Before Christmas. Wow. Set it up the same day. Hey, you see, this is God's pattern on how to build and what he's doing and his confirmations and what he's saying. And I walk in here and I drop the book down, the lampstand. I go by Scott's house. And, you know, he just got from his dead grandfather two menorahs that's in his house. I just saw it. These are all, then, God just doesn't stop. So I come in here looking for this book because I knew everything that just went down with the menorah, God revealing what the menorah is, the church, and all of this stuff that's happening, I'm like, my God, I just put the menorah with the menorah, right? The light. I set it down. God starts connecting these dots, so when I walk in, you know, I'm looking for the book. Where's the book? The book's gone. I call my wife. Where's the book? She took it and brought it in. So I grabbed the book. And I opened the page up, and inside of the book is the paper. I didn't put it in here.
Oh, right here.
See?
That's the logo for the children's ministry.
This is the logo for the church.
Well, it's the different one. It's not the one you get.
I know.
But it's a logo for the church.
When I opened this book, look at that. It says, the Citadel Church, revealing the work of his hands. You see, all this is about, God had me pick up a chainsaw a week and a half ago to see if I can carve out a face. You know, it all started a week and a half ago. 2 weeks ago now, huh? 2 weeks ago. Listen, we set the church up 2 weeks ago. The same time we're setting up the church, I get this crazy idea. If I can carve a bear in a piece of wood this big, just out of the blue, man, I want to be able to carve it in something this big, or this big, or this big. So I went inside, and I sat down at the table, and I took my felt knife, this one right here, and took that little piece of 3-inch wood and carved out a little bear. And my wife's like, I told you you could do it. Why? I've been to Tennessee for the last 10 or 15 years, whatever it's been. My wife has always loved the bears. They cost a ton of money. All of a sudden, God says, sits me down and says, you know, puts in my spirit to carve. He asked my son, I sat down, started carving, and I was like, wow, I had no idea I could do it. So you know what? I'm going to grab my chainsaw. I'm going to call my wife a bear. Little did I know, that was the Spirit of the Lord moving over me for the meeting that I had with Brother Norwood C. Moore. Because you know what I've been working on this whole time to get right in carving? The face. The face. Because it's all about his face. And if I could cut away things, that's what I do. I pull things apart so that I can reveal it to you. So I can reveal exactly what Rebecca said last night. If you can't see the face of Jesus, if you can't see Jesus in this place, you're blind. Oh, that's awesome. You see, God will take us down a path. We'll do things we don't even know why we're doing it. But all of this carving, am I going to stop carving? No. I'm still struggling with that face too.
You should practice a couple more days.
You know, I make some crazy, you ought to see some of these things, man. But for the most part, you can walk up to it and see, that's a bear. When we set this place up, my mom said, you know what? It looks like you're lifting up the ark when, you know, we really need to be seeing Jesus, the face of Jesus. Just like God had me go put that crown up on top of those wings, the cherubim wings, right? And the cross comes and slips in. It's all about the ability to be able, you, to show people Jesus. You have to be able to show them Jesus first in your own life. Because If they don't see Jesus in you, there's nothing you can tell them.
Amen.
The only thing, I can put a log right here in front of this church and look at it, and I could see a bear. And I say, man, there's a log in that bear. There's a bear in that log. Where? It's like my son. I told my son, I said, son, Zechariah, I said, I want you to, because he's been watching me a little bit, but he hasn't been paying attention to what I've been doing. Son, you haven't been paying attention to what Daddy's been doing. Ministry. That's a word from the Lord for you. But God says, man, when you begin to pay attention, He'll begin to show you. Just like, you know, this is a word for you, son. Straight from God. I was carving this bear. She's beautiful. That's what my mother-in-law said. She's absolutely beautiful. A bear, got a cub sticking out here and a cub sticking out there. I got down to the bottom of the body, and I'm just looking at the bottom. And I said, son, come look at this bear. I see it. No, son, I want you to come take your time, and I want you to look at this bear and tell me what you see. What should I do with the bottom of this bear? He said, you know, Dad, looking at it, now that I'm looking at it, she needs to be sitting down, and you can cut the back of it out. Follow that, take the back out, put her sitting down, and you could sit her on a log. And he showed me how he saw it. He saw perfectly well. I said, you know what? That's how this bear is supposed to be, sitting down. But you know what? I didn't listen. I didn't listen. But you know what? It's funny. I carved that bear's bottom. And she's standing up. And from one side, she looks good. And from the other side, she looks good. And I'm sorry, guys. I'm going to stop. And from the front, she looks good. But when you walk behind her, you're like, I'm going to write a sign behind her, don't laugh. Because her butt is about this far too low. It is funny. No butt, crazy looking from the back. Right? But I should have listened. And the word of the Lord is trying to tell you, son, is when you sit down, when you stop, God is going to begin to show you things. Because you can see. But you need to sit down and rest. And you know what? Get back in your word. And start seeking Him again. Like He used to do every day. And He'll begin to reveal Himself to you. You've been distracted by everything, and God has called you to do something. And you need to be obedient to it. But anyway, guys, I'm going to stop. I'm not finished, though, but I'm going to quit. Stop.
Can I point something out?
Yes.
The position of those wings on the ark might not be correct, but actually it is correct. There are four. There's two wings on each angel, and then the wings you and your daddy made. Each angel has four wings.
Wow.
They're just not stretched out behind you.
Wow. Yes. Right. And now you know that menorah, it represents the church. And what God has called us to do, right? And He said, build it according to the pattern that I showed you. So that's what we're going to be doing. That's where we're going. That's what God's doing. So I'm going to pray and then I'm going to answer your question. Father, in Jesus' name, Lord, you're amazing. Thank you, Father, for showing us your Son, Jesus. Amen, amen, and amen.